Well, the full complement of matches in round 11 of the URC, a welcome change in many respects after the recent disruption to the schedule, particularly over that busy Christmas New Year period. A first game in the URC, at least in charge for Emiliano Bergamaschi, and he makes five changes from the side beaten in Parma by Worcester in the Challenge Cup last Saturday. Four of his five Italian international players make the match day squad of 23, just 7 days out, of course, from the Six Nations, including the club captain David Cici, who starts in the second row. No change in the halfback. It's Violi and O'Malley continuing their partnership. Lucin and Cronje retained as the midfield axis, and junior Lalua Fifi completing the back three. Munster, well, they come here in a rich vein of form, as we know, and off the back of that six try salvo in Europe against Wasps last week. 11 changes for Munster from last weekend's six try rout of the Wasps at Thomond Park. John Klein, of course, now in his sixth season at the province, and with five Ireland caps to his name, wins his 100th cap tonight. A big milestone for him, the 12th member of this current squad to reach that impressive milestone. Klein, one of four players retained in the Munster forward pack, so that means it's a completely new back line tonight. But as ever, well, they will come here expecting to win. They have done so on each of their trips to Parma, and it's 17 out of 17 all told against Zebra. In fact, they haven't lost to an Italian side since they were beaten by Benetton in September of 2013. Jack O'Donoghue wears the Munster armband tonight. And there is John Klein. What a night it is for him to celebrate the achievement of playing 100 times and still plenty left in the tank. 6'8" South African-born second row cap, five times, as I said, by Ireland, all of those coming in 2019, and his last to date at the Rugby World Cup in the autumn of Japan in that year. Here come the home side. And as I said, it is something of a new era for this Italian side, now under the tutelage of Emiliano Bergamaschi, having taken over from Michael Bradley. We are under the watchful eye of a Welsh referee tonight, his 26th game in this competition, Craig Evans. Paul Marshall alongside me to enjoy it. It is a big, big task for this Zebra side, and we're always interested at Six Nations time to see which of the sides will be depleted. Now, they do have quite a few of their Italian contingent in situ tonight, but you would still fancy Munster to come here and try and fill their boots.
Absolutely, Connor, and I think Munster, obviously 17 wins out of 17 previously against Zebra. They'll be coming in with full of confidence, and it's always interesting at this time of the year, as you mentioned, about internationals and squad rotation and things, and many players end up getting opportunities in these sort of games. And I know when I was a player, at times these were the games I was looking forward to try and get an opportunity to stake a claim, to try and stay involved, especially when there's knockout rugby coming around the corner.
So many players to keep an eye on in Munster Red tonight, not least, of course, Jake Flannery, but it's going to be the opposite number, Tim O'Malley, the 10 for Zebra, to get us underway here. Pitch in with splendid condition. We commented in the game that on Christmas Eve, in fact, against Benetton, the pitch was showing plenty of wear and tear, but there's a good surface for these two teams to try and take all advantage of tonight, and conditions set for barely a puff of breeze, really. Can Munster set about their business early doors here, complete a good exit. Neil Cronin is the halfback partner for Jake Flannery. Flannery has been playing quite a bit of his rugby of late at fullback for Shannon in the AIL. Nine, I think it is, of 23 involved in the AIL last week, which is really great in terms of a feeder competition at this level. Great to see.
Two and two there. Receiver.
I think it's really important for the club game as well, because there's always a wee bit of a battle between the club game and the professional game. So when players are available, it's great that they're released to play.
Get back in. Hit.
This team that Munster have put out tonight, it's very close to the team that went across to West Wales and beat the Scarlets and beat them handsomely by a margin of 40 points back in October. It's pretty much an identical back line with the exception of Flannery. It was Ben Healy that afternoon.
It's a tackle now, Red. Release. It's a release.
Now Zebra have hands on here in midfield, trying to carry the fight in the opening 2 minutes to Munster and get something going. Well, they have a penalty. And a chance to get some territorial advantage if they want to pop this over in the right-hand corner, down around the 22, perhaps.
You could see, obviously, in that very first maul, Jack O'Donoghue getting stuck in. He's a player that I really rate. I think he is fantastic week on week when he performs for Munster. Obviously, the youngest player to get the 150 caps for Munster, which says an awful lot when you think of all the quality that's come through there over the years. And he's obviously going to want the lead from the front today, being the captain.
Still the next lineup there because they came up.
Well, I did mention that it's a good evening for the kickers and very too much breeze to contend with. I did wonder, is it just beyond the radar of Tim O'Malley? But he fancies this.
Good, those guys information early, we can deal with
and
that.
I agree with Neil about Jack O'Donoghue. It's a long time now since he won the second of those two Ireland caps that he has to date against Japan in 2017. He was, of course, initially selected for the Six Nations in 2020. Let's see if O'Malley can settle a few early nerves here. Take full advantage of that breakdown penalty. He's got to be close to the periphery of his compass, you would think. Has he got the distance? It's very, very close. Not to be, though.
Make sure they're all behind you.
It would have been a nice start there for Zebre under new management. Playing at home, it would have been a nice start if they were able to get a penalty and settle the nerves early on, but certainly they've started brightly.
Much travelled. New Zealand-born number 10, Tim O'Malley. He's played in Japan, he's played in the United States.
Tackle!
Carry back from Renato Ciamarioli. A couple of hefty challenges right on halfway, and has ever looked to put some width on it. Balawa Fihi is always a player to keep a close eye on. He's so dynamic, lovely feet, great pace. Ball's just gone forward, this has a little bit sloppy. Jamie Barron, of course, into that Munster front row alongside Jeremy Lockman and Keenan Knox. Just his fourth start, actually. Jeremy Barron, a player who you think has been around a little bit longer than that. He's played, well, tonight's his 23rd appearance, but he's only starting his fourth game. Started last week against Wasps and was very impressive, but so were most of that Munster team last week. Really, really good, particularly in the first half, and a lot of dynamism around their attack, which is something that we know they've been hugely critical of recently.
I think that was the really pleasing thing, you know, as a rugby fan, was that Munster were looking much more dynamic in attack. And as you said, you know, there's been a few critical words said about their attack, especially with the likes of Stephen Larkham in there, who everyone knows of our generation, what a fantastic playmaker he was for Australia for so long. And obviously, he'll be moving on at the end of the year as well, so no doubt whoever ends up going into that role will want to try and take things to the next level, because it feels like Munster maybe haven't quite developed just as much as we would have hoped for.
4 minutes in and the first scrum of the evening.
Crouch!
Bonfiglio, Fabiani and Eduardo Bejo on the tight head side.
Set!
The Argentinian
Steady.
International for Zebre.
Sorry?
Three front rows down, but it will go down as a completed scrummage because Craig Evans happy to let Neil Cronin get on with things. Into midfield they go to Liam Coombs. A little bit over-eager from Munster. And you can see the second
Cody
penalty.
Red taken out beyond the breakdown.
Yeah, it's not really the ideal start you want from your first starter play. You want to try and get into the game. And it's always one that I'm always a wee bit dubious of sometimes in the refereeing. I'm sort of thinking it's one that sometimes it's not had a big bearing on the play. They could have probably let the game go on, but you obviously can't take a player out too far beyond the ruck.
Calvin Nash, I forgive him to a degree for being a little bit eager. He hasn't played since an ankle injury back in October. Just his third start of the season. He one of the players that did manage to get a try in that game against the Scarlets that I spoke about. So Fabiani hits his target.
That's over. That's one tonight.
Just his initial mall defence is good, sturdy. No real progress for the Zebre pack. They get moving with Violi and into midfield. Nice exchange. Luchin showing good hands. And then Jeremy Barron in there. Seemed to be legal and on his feet. Referee well placed, Craig Evans. Munster have turned it over. Cronin has they look to move it through the hands, and Coombs once again finding himself in that somewhat alien position of outside centre, but he's proved more than capable when he's been asked to play there. But I think he's much more comfortable either at fullback or on the wing. Explosive pace.
Let's go! Use his hands, yes, use his hands, bollock.
Thrown it. Was that touched? Doesn't find touch over on that far side. Instead, it's picked up by Jakubo Trusia. One of the players who might have fancied he would be in the Italian squad for the Six Nations, but he's not made the select group. Going to ground, that is Liam Mitchell. Zebra having plenty of ball early doors here, and they're spotting one or two gaps in that Munster rear guard. Alo Afifi thought about the pass to Giamma Roli, who kept the width out on this near side, and now they just haven't protected the ball well enough from a good position. Munster able to hack it downfield, and O'Malley under pressure here, and Nash does well to get him into touch. That's a really good gain of ground when they were under pressure a few seconds ago.
Yeah, it's been a really lively start from Zebra, and Marcelo Violi, he's a talented operator at nine. He's got over 20 caps for Italy, and he likes to keep the ball moving quickly, and it was a great line from Junior Lalulifi, and just unfortunately he tried to force the offload, but super play from Calvin Nash, and he's chased it up really well. Now Munster end up in a good position where they could set up their maul, hopefully.
Stay tight, lads.
Barron goes all the way towards the tail, and it's been picked off. Delivery looked a little bit short, but it was a good read from Zebra. And a little bit of a let off for them if they can exit their own 22 clearly and clinically here. Won't find touch. Nash swings one all the way infield. Loose pass. Long way over the head of Gallagher. That's a real scrappy ball, and it's gone forward. We did mention the fact that it's 11 changes and no real fluidity or continuity, and a little bit loose really from Munster, isn't it?
Yeah, and I think that sort of is anticipated in some ways, where you know there's so many changes that it takes players a wee while to obviously get into the game again. Some players won't have played at this level for a while, but you're also playing away from home against the Zebre team who've had a change in management. So these players now are getting their opportunity under the new coach, and they know that if they want to try and stay within the team, they have to perform, and this is their first shop window really for their new management. So Munster maybe just sort of forcing it there a little bit with the pass, but great line speed from Henry Cronje, and he's right up on the ball. Next player's coming, and nasty cut there it looks like, but certainly it's been a good start.
They have spoken to number one, okay?
Matt Gallagher, another of those who's played, well, precious little rugby, really. Just his third start of the season. Some concern for Graham Rowntree and Johan van Graan on the Munster coaching ticket. Well, certainly from a Zebra point of view, I mean, they are in this period of transition, and they've been unlucky over the last number of weeks. They've been beset by COVID problems, and their games in Europe have been disrupted, and they've been down personnel. He's not really had the full complement of a squad to train with yet, Bergamaschke, but when you've been listening to the same voice in the dressing room for 4 years and things appear a little bit stale, sometimes it's just good to get a new perspective.
Absolutely, and it sometimes doesn't even mean that things are changing massively in terms of tactics, but it's just, as you say, it's a fresh voice. It's someone who maybe does some things slightly differently, someone who might change the training program for that week, and just a freshness and a new impetus sometimes can really kickstart a team. And we've seen with Zebre over the last few years, at times they've shown signs of improvement, but then they just haven't kicked on to the next level. And I think for Italian rugby, that's what we would love to see. We'd love to see two really competitive Italian teams.
Time on. Good stability.
Jack Crowley's going to have to come in.
Good stability there.
So that is not the start that Munster were looking for. 8.5 minutes in and forced into that blood sub change. Let's see if we can get things patched up and back to the starting complement. 2017, 2018, I think, which the high watermark really from a Zebra point of view. They won seven of their 21 matches in the Pro 14, but they've barely won that many in the 3 years or 3.5 years since then.
Hopefully for Jake Flannery it's nothing too serious. Hopefully he can get patched up and get back on. It's his first start of 10. Obviously you don't want to be going off in the first 10 minutes for a blood injury and not being able to return, but hopefully he'll be able to return to the field. But another good young out half, Jack Crowley, comes on as well, so it's good to see two young out halves, local boys, playing for Munster today.
Absolutely, we know all about Jack Crowley's talents. A lot of players, a lot of people rather, were surprised to see Ben Healy back in at 10 last week after Crowley acquitted himself so well in a really tight game away in France against Cast. But Healy more than vindicated Johan van Graan's decision last week, had a really super game, was brilliant in the first half. Crowley a different sort of player, but it's Zebra on the attack here, looking to try and make inroads. And this time the decision, shrill blast from Craig Evans goes the other way, and it benefits Munster, who get the penalty.
22 on his feet.
And it was Jack Crowley in over competing over the ball, so you don't see too many out halves wanting to get into that position and get their head over the ball and compete, but super first play for him, and it's a positive one.
The thing that impressed me so much about his play in those big European games was, even when things didn't go exactly right, there was a couple of little handling errors and misplaced passes. He didn't hide away. He always wants the ball. He's always looking to get involved and use that footwork that he has.
I think as a number 10 as well, everyone looks to you to be the rock in your team. And if you're having a slightly off day or if you're making a mistake, if you let that show, it can really breed a bit of doubt throughout your whole team. So it's important being able to park those small errors.
Byron this time goes to the front of the lineout. Munster secure. Good ball.
Release, block, release.
Cronin.
No knock on there.
Ball just hit a foot, delayed the pass. And you go to O'Donoghue, he's brought to ground. Then Cronin will work it out this way to Dan Goggin. Back inside now, Calvin Nash. Can he spot a little bit of daylight among those black shirts? Plenty of numbers to the left. Lockman gets hands on and Goggin again. And they switch it out to Shane Daly. Good to see him back in action and getting more game time as well. Again, Munster a little bit sloppy in terms of looking after the ball, been turned over.
Red's lost now, Red. Use it, Black. Back.
Only taking
push
his time
back
to use all that protection that he has. Sending up the box kick. Good take from Gallagher. Not under a huge amount of pressure, but clean take, and Munster now with the option to try and run it from inside their own half. Strong carry again from Jack O'Sullivan, with eight on his back tonight for Munster. John Hodnett on the open side flank, and Jack O'Donoghue, as we said, on the blind side. Good to see Hodnett back in really good form again after that long injury, out for 11 months or a little bit more than that. That one just holding up a fraction. Really good take from Truja.
No.
Dominated the airspace and made that his own.
Push back. Get back.
Marcelo Violi. Munster claiming offside. I actually thought there was somebody offside. It might well have been Pierre Bruno from the kick from the scrum half on the other side, but nothing doing from the referee.
Not a hand yet.
A wee bit disappointed Munster box kicked that. They'd obviously taken Zebra to the edge. They're still in possession. Relatively quick ball still on the halfway line. I would like to have seen them maybe try and keep that in hand. And
time off.
Just an unfortunate mistake there from Jack O'Donoghue, and just a little bit of indecision as to whether to try and get in and catch the ball or use his foot maybe to stop it. And he has come off him and gone out for a Zebra lineup.
16 tackles, I think it was, on man of the match on his 150th appearance for Jack O'Donoghue.
That's the
19 tries over the course of that really good career so far. Still only 28, of course.
I think that's the really exciting thing when you look through the Munster team today. You know, we're talking about Dermot Barron earlier on, feeling like he's been around the block for a while. He's only 23. Keenan Knox only 22, Scott Buckley on the bench, Joshua Shirley 21, 22. So it's quite exciting seeing these young front rowers coming through.
And Scott Buckley scored a try on his Munster debut at the Ricoh Arena against Wasps, and has looked very, very good anytime he's been given a chance. Recently signed a 2-year contract, of course. Off the bench, it'll be his URC debut tonight. Now line-out ball cleanly taken by Zebra. There is the aforementioned Hodnett in customary fashion with a scything challenge. But Zebra come again. Well, it's loose for Violi. Did well to reposition himself. Lambonin gets hands on the big second row. slow ball though for Violi to try and work off, and that's cleverly through the hands from O'Malley, but it was difficult for Laloifi to take. And they reset with another scrummage over on that far side. There lots of bluster and endeavour from Zebra, just maybe not as clinical and as precise as they need to be with the ball.
Absolutely, and exactly. They're trying really hard, but it's just not quite there, that level of accuracy. And probably from both teams so far in the opening sort of 15 minutes, it's been a little bit scrappy, and both teams are just trying to find
exactly
their way in the game. And
last scrum was good.
Nobody really has taken charge just yet.
Nine defeats on the bounce this season in all competitions. It's 18 in succession since that last victory that they had against the Dragons in February of 2021, winning that one 26-15.
Bind! Set! Early, number three.
Two front rows in the previous early. Two. Scrummages have gone down in a heap, and
wait
there,
for the
free
set.
Kick.
Going after the word, not the start.
Pretty clear in front of Craig Evans.
Early. Okay. 10 yards, lads. Push.
So up it goes, skyward from Crowley. Kick chase is good. Tackle is also. Zebra have to be smart about their business here. O'Malley's under pressure. Two Munster players over it. One of those, Jeremy Lockman.
Stop. Now you can go.
Up it goes from Violi. Plenty of kicking from hand. Now Crowley might just fancy that. Hang on to it here. Stopped in the tackle by Andrea Lambonin.
Advantage.
There's the new Centurion, John Klein, with hands on.
Seven offside, Dan taking the space. Pelly advantage
here
going
against Bianchi.
Yes.
Advantage, so back we go.
Yeah, again, I'd like to see Munster being a little bit
offside.
More creative there. You have a penalty advantage, it's a free ball. You could try a crossfield kick even, just, or obviously have a running play. You could do something a little bit more inventive maybe than the box kick there. And you know the penalty's coming, so you've got the free ball. You may as well try and do something creative. Bit of a needless penalty to give away there from Bianchi, and it just puts his team under a bit of pressure here. Munster will look to get territory and try and get a bit of a stronghold in this game.
It's been a real weapon, of course, right down the years, but also this season for Munster. Can they get something moving off this line out? Put the Zebra pack under pressure.
How many?
22, just a couple of weeks ago, Jack Crowley.
Boys, who's... All right, boys, look, there's a lot
Brandon
of people
Brammer.
In this area, boys. Who's in and who's... Come
big influence on the Ireland under-20 side.
Fish 2 metres.
Back in 2020, everyone remembers
time
that
on.
Game against Scotland where he was so
nine.
Good at Musgrave Park, scoring
back.
A couple
Let
of brilliant tries and running the show. Klein is the target at line-out time, and Munster have it. Can they manufacture something with it? Back to Crowley they go. Didn't have a huge amount of support. Coombs trying to get on his shoulder, and now they recycle and they go in behind.
Oh, no advantage.
Hodnett.
Advantage, clear the area.
Tim O'Malley on the wrong side, and not making enough of a picture to show Craig Evans of trying to get out of the way. That's another penalty.
To the wrong side.
I think Munster are maybe a little bit lucky. It'll be interesting to see that one again, but I think it looked like a bit of crossing going on there. And I know the referee said it wasn't having any bearing, but I think John Hodnett's right in the way there. John Klein runs into him. They can't make the tackle, and then it ends up being a penalty for someone not rolling away. So I think Zebra probably a wee bit harshly dealt there.
Back at 10 metres, please.
Yeah, 17 and a half minutes, they've struggled to break down this Zebra rear guard so far, so perhaps wisely and predictably, the option straight in front of the post is to go for the 3 points.
I think it's been a scrappy opening quarter, really, so I think Munster are doing the right thing here. Take the points, try and take a little bit of the sting out of Zebra. They've obviously been buoyant in their first opening quarter of the game, but just take a little bit of sting out of them. They've lost 18 games in the bounce. Once they start going points behind, certainly their confidence isn't going to start to grow with that sort of record behind them. So if Munster can just start edging out in front, that's all they'll be looking to do.
Relatively straightforward. Plenty of conviction behind the kick, and Munster a little over 18 minutes into the contest, get the first points on the board. And a penalty for Jack Crowley.
You can't tackle with the board. He goes into his own man.
It's something they've been guilty of this season, going right back to the very first match of the campaign against the Emirates Lions, where I think they were 38 points to nil down before they decided 10 minutes into the second half they could play a little bit of rugby and scored maybe 20 unanswered points to get themselves back into it. And the similar last time I commentated on the game in Parma for that game against Benetton at Christmas time, they were a long, long way behind. They don't score a lot of points in the first half. They tend to score all their points in the final quarter of games when at that stage usually it's game up. And Munster looking to up the intensity and kick on after that penalty. Finian Witcherly alongside John Klein in the engine room tonight.
Use!
Carried back is the instruction from Craig Evans. Up it goes from Cronin. Very, very tight to that touchline over on the far side. Contact in the air, it seemed, on Shane Daly potentially.
Okay, that was off the chest and not going to the touch.
It's a great box kick. Right in the trams. Shane Daly's right in there competing heavily. And they always say the old phrase of the kick's only as good as its chase. Shane Daly's had a couple of great kick chases already, and he'll be someone who's probably a wee bit disappointed to have sort of fallen out of the Irish squad over the last wee while, and he'll be itching to try and take his opportunity tonight to try and get kicked on with his own career again.
The caps to his credit against Georgia and then Japan. Here's Hodden, and that's what he can do with his footwork. Such a dynamic runner for all his strengths in terms of his tackle count and his carries. That's really good turn of pace as well. Put this Sabre defence back on their heels. Now Cronin works that blind side again. Shane Daly on the 22. Cronin now a little bit high and in behind. Jamie Barron had to stretch for it.
Ball is out.
Cronin once more now. Crowley, really tight corridor to work in there. Got his pass away to Keenan Knox. Witcherly now. Here's Jack O'Donoghue. This is better and more enterprising from a Munster point of view. Cronin didn't have too many options on that short side. Back in they go to Crowley now. Barrett brought to ground by Eduardo Bejo, the Puma. Ball is there for Cronin. So too for Jeremy Lockman. Gallagher this time getting involved. That was okay, wasn't held, could carry on legally. Flip back inside, is there space there for Shane Daly? Klein, Crowley again, and just the sense that Munster beginning to warm to the task now. Numbers wide here, should be an easy run in for Jack O'Donoghue for the first try of the evening, and they get it just beyond the opening first quarter. Really good continuity for the first time in the game, really, from either side, particularly from Munster, and no real surprise that it ends up in a 20th try in Munster colours for the captain, Jack O'Donoghue.
That's what we've been waiting for Munster to do, get a bit of quick ball, get the ball into the wide channels, some lovely offloads in there, and it's a super, super finish. Liam Coombs just draws the last defender in beautifully. Jack O'Donoghue's keeping his width, and it looks so simple when you get it right, but it's so, so effective.
Well, they were stressing that Zebra defence right across the park.
That timing is good there.
Yeah, this is just a case of using the space and the numbers. Please. It all started really with that bust from John Hodnett, but it's a good timing from Coombs.
I'm not going to give him the leak. Takes the first time, man. It's not a joke.
It's nice we saw Neil Cronin trying a little inside flip to Shane Daly, and they're obviously going to try and challenge this Zebra team across the park. And you can't just play teams going wide to wide. You have to try and go through them at times. And John Hodnett obviously got a great gain line, which started the whole thing.
Camera shot to appreciate the angle facing Crowley, not to be for him. Just across the face, and he is called back ashore, because the good news is that Jake Flannery has been patched up and is okay to continue. A little cameo of exactly what Jack Crowley can bring in terms of his link-up play as well, as we look at the try again. whom smashed by Laloifi, but he'd got his pass away to that man, Jack O'Donoghue. Points to nil in the first quarter, just beyond us. Now, what can Zebra muster in terms of a riposte to try and get themselves into this game? It was a decent opening 10 minutes, but it's been more like Munster business as usual since then. They do like to play strike from deep. Big tackle on Jacobo Trusia. Trying to work that short side again. Cutting up there with a tackle. Quicker ball that time for Violi. Richardy trying to get over it. Manages to slow it down. Violi then. Munster there in numbers. Klein and O'Sullivan in particular. Ball's taken an age to come back, and it's not coming back, but it will be Munster ball.
That was a maul before he became a tackle.
It's a great hit in the midfield there from Dan Goggin. And again, it sets the tone, you know, when you get your first carry, your first big tackle in. And we know it's 25 minutes in, but the game's been a bit scrappy. But it's the first time we've seen Dan Goggin coming out and really making a big offensive tackle there.
Look, we're just talking a split second there.
Sometimes when you come away to these Italian sides in Parma, it can be just a case of being patient, going through the structures and trusting the fact that you have the quality on the pitch. And sometimes you can be in a little bit of a hurry to do everything. And as you say, so many players looking to impress. We haven't really mentioned Jack O'Sullivan yet. And that midfield combination as well of Dan Goggin and Liam Coombs, I mean, all the while second fiddle behind the likes of Damien D'Alande, and it's great for them to get an opportunity to play potentially 80 minutes tonight.
Yeah, and it's great they're playing with each other. They were playing against each other in the AIL last week, so they're obviously lined out from together in the midfield. And again, we say this all the time, you know, players get opportunities in these sort of games and they'll want to put a good foot forward. And there's obviously a bit of speculation about the likes of Damien D'Alande, will he still be there next year? So, you know, they'll be certainly looking to take their chance.
So Cronin feeds, and there it is for O'Sullivan, but he won't have to play it because Munster have the penalty.
Slip your bind and straight the ground. Ted.
Clear instruction from Craig Evans against Eduardo Bejo on that tight head side. Fifth season at Zebra for the Argentinian international. We mentioned four of the five Zebra players in that Italy squad involved tonight, two starting and two on the bench. The only one not is the prop forward on the loose head side, Fischetti, who's nursing a bit of an injury, otherwise he might be involved as well. Now this is a good platform for Munster to try and tighten their grip on this game.
10 meters. 9 back.
So Donoghue the target this time. And Munster off and motoring now.
Three leave the leg.
Grabbing infield and briefly brought to a halt. Cronin assesses the options. Flannery, first touch he's got since he's come back in, and that pass might have gone to hand to Cronin, and surely he would have been in for 5 or 7 points.
It's a great option going back to that short side. You could see as the maul was starting to edge infield that there was a bit of space, and Zebra didn't defend it particularly well. You could see that they were given space inside and outside. Trio was given a bit of space inside and outside, and it's a good call from Jake Flannery coming back, and unfortunately just couldn't get the offload away. But great feat, good that he got his hands free, and if that had gone to hands for Neil Cronin, it probably would have been a try.
Nothing changes your red.
Just great to see him back in.
Good.
Would have been very, very difficult to take had he been forced off with that nasty cut that he got so early in the game, with so much expectation of trying to get minutes under the belt here this evening. He'll be under pressure here as Zebra. Keep it in the scrum, solid enough, and away goes Violi. Flannery trying to make up for some lost time, another physical challenge. The ball is a little bit loose and dangerous. Violi right on his own try line now, and he's swarmed upon by 3 or 4 Munster players. They'll need to protect it here with everything they've got.
Yeah,
Sean Klein coming in.
Stay.
Dojo brings it clear, but only a meter or two.
Use it!
Again, they look to curry rather than kick into the hands of Bianchi, the open
Count
side.
Back through the middle, it's fine. Extra step, push.
Keenan Knox going in there with plenty of force, and when they do finally elect to kick, he can't quite get it outside the 22. And I'm wondering, has Fioli done himself an injury there? He seemed to just grimace and clutch his quad muscle, I think it was, after he kicked that.
I think that might have just been a wee bit of a... He hooked it maybe not as well as he'd have liked to have kicked it, and he gave the old grab...
Saving exercise, yeah.
Grab your leg and make it look as if you maybe hurt yourself. But it's great pressure from Munster. I mean, just counter-rucking, coming in again, second efforts. Neil Cronin in competing for the ball. They're just not letting Zebre get out of there easily. And now Munster get the reward of a line-out in around the 22, and they can either, again, set up that maul that was looking good, or they can take it off the top and try and get a bit of pace into the midfield.
Well, plenty changing behind the scenes at Zebre Parma in the last year, 18 months. They've got a new president. They've full of new ideas.
Okay.
And obviously felt that Michael Bradley's time had been well served over the course of the 4 years that he was there. He did at times have them punching above their weight. I mentioned that season, 2017-2018, when they played some very, very good rugby, won seven of their games. But they're looking to up their recruitment and try and change things root and branch from the bottom to the top.
Okay,
it'll be a long-term project. They've quite a ways to go, as their results would suggest, over the last number of years, really. As we said, it's almost a full year since they won a game, and that has to change. They're under pressure here. And that's high on Dan Goggin, who took a lovely line. It may not matter. It will not matter. No stopping. Munster now in for their second try on all his own work. 10th try on Munster colours for Dan Goggin, the former young player of the year. And he enjoyed that with the penalty advantage for the high tackle.
That is an incredible line from Dan Goggin. He's hit the line at such pace. He's coming back against the grain. He's not spotted. It's a lovely pass from Neil Cronin. And it's nice seeing Munster use a bit of variation. They've mauled, they've gone off the top. They've had a peel play there with the wraparound. And Dan Goggin's done unbelievably well to fight through that first tackle and continue and score the try. But it all comes from a beautiful line.
Loose from Liam Mitchell, then Violi came across. He couldn't quite scrag him, nor to Bejo. Belligerent, strong, aggressive running from Dan Goggin. And the extras added by Jake Flannery, who gets himself on the score sheet with a conversion. All his points so far have come in a Munster shirt at this ground. He was on target last season against the same opposition. 15 points to nil, and they stretch the lead out to. And once again, we're talking about Zebre playing catch-up rugby in the first half of a URC game. Familiar territory for them.
And that's exactly what Munster wanted to do now. They've got three scores ahead. They've settled into the game. They're starting to get the penalties in around the scrum or ruck and maul time. And as is every player now, that seed of doubt starts to creep in. You're thinking, oh no, here we go again. We're points down, more coming.
They have been on the receiving end of a couple of very hefty defeats at the hands of Munster in recent seasons. Over 100 points in the last two games, in fact. 54 points here in the Rainbow Cup last June, I think it was, that night that Gavin Coombs scored four tries. Munster have scored 16 in the last two games against Zebre.
Look, no, you can't go quick, I'm setting the gap. There's your mark. Munster, one line the front man.
Keenan Knox, the starting tight head tonight. Good to see Roman Salanoa on the bench as well, back from that knee injury. 24-year-old USA under 20 player, Hawaiian-born prop, plenty of potential.
15.
Good take from Mitchell. He's very effective in the line-out. He's the top tackler so far in the European Challenge Cup this season. He was very impressive against Benetton last time out for Zebre in the URC as well. I thought he was the most effective player on the park that night.
Some more!
Munster. We've seen this two or three times already in the game, and they're going to get the ball back again. Eric Cronier, the player, just swallowed up, engulfed by four or five Munster players. Nothing he could do to try and get the ball away. Couldn't get the ground.
That's great work from Jack O'Sullivan and Liam Coombs, just able to get in and hold the ball up, create the maul. You know, then you can fall on the ball when the maul's, if the maul goes to ground, you know, you can fall on it. The ball doesn't have to come out. You'll get the scrum. It's just a wee bit disappointing from Zebrae. They got a good gain line in that first phase, and then they've gone back inside to forwards. It was nice to see them trying to do something a little bit more proactive and put Munster under pressure when Munster on the back foot, and they just gave Munster time to get their defence set again. And if you run up upright into some of these Munster forwards and big backs, you're going to struggle to get the ball back to ground.
Bind! Set! Don't push in!
Controlled at the base by O'Sullivan. Moving on to the right this way. Two front rows are up. We'll do that all again, says Craig Evans.
He just gone sideways. That was a good contest. And just
the props look round at Neil Cronin and say, any chance of you getting that ball out? We've had a steady scrum. I'm surprised the referee didn't actually call to use it. You know, they're doing that now whenever the ball's sitting at number 8's feet, and it was steady, it could have gone. And I know the look I would have received as a former scrum half when the ball was sitting there and you didn't use it and they were having to pack down again.
Crouch! Bind!
Zebra front row vastly more experienced.
Set.
Right across. And their Munster opponents. And this time it's loose. Hacked ahead.
Ball
wasn't out. Didn't hear the referee say that it was. Could have been a great deal in it, but Violi called back.
The ball is not out of the scrum. You kicked it.
Nearly out.
It looked like it was certainly behind the flanker's foot. And if it's not sort of at the number 8's feet, you could argue that it maybe was out. But at the end of the day, we're just mere watchers. If Craig Evans says it's not out, it's not out. And that's the call. But maybe a wee bit harsh there on Marcelo Violi. But it's just not really what Zebrae needed. You don't need to give away another penalty. You know, Munster get another chance to try and get a bit of pressure on and around the Zebrae 22. And just hasn't paid off for him.
5 minutes or a little more than that to half time, and having kept them to 15 points, they'd like to get into the sheds and try and see about coming out and making amends. They can ill afford to ship another 5 or 7 here. And Munster converting the so-called championship minutes, kicking option from Flannery on that occasion, just pinned Zebrae back. He did have lots of options to his right.
I think he was maybe hoping for that to stay in play, and then Violi would have been under huge pressure, but still, Zebrae are camped in their own line, and Munster have certainly been competing hard so far.
No, we can't go quick, and you just step over.
I think they're lucky they didn't get that one quick, it didn't look too straight.
Jack O'Donoghue poised here to try and disrupt and get off the ground, and in the end, that one definitely wasn't. And it's all about the pressure, isn't it? In that area of the field.
Scrum or line out? Line out call, boys.
They're going to find themselves, you would think, under considerable pressure from Munster's line out maul here, which has been such an effective weapon this season.
Fabiani will be disappointed with that now. He got away with the first one when it was called back, and then he's thrown two crooked in a row there just at that little phase of play.
Five. No.
Clean ball for Witcherly. Referee happy now. Can Munster make it pay dividends? Barrett, and off they go. Zebrae bottom on the floor, but Barrett has broken off the base there. Now Zebrae must release and Keenan Knox funnels one out. That looks very, very close. Dive for the line, maybe a foot or two short.
Advantage, 7 hands in front.
Friendly advantage now. Will Munster just keep it in the forwards here, or will they try something a little bit more elaborate? That's Wycherley over now. If he can manage to ground that, because if he's not, albeit with penalty advantage, yeah, he's got that down. Pretty sure it is Finnan Wycherley who's going to get the third try of the evening for Munster here, 3 or 4 minutes before half time. Barron was in there too. Plenty of support as they got the latch on.
Yeah, Munster are just really squeezing Zebre now every opportunity that they get. I actually thought the Munster throw into the line out there maybe didn't look the straightest. It didn't look too different to the Zebre throw a second ago, but obviously it wasn't called. And Munster, when they get in close to your line, they're so good at that pick and go. And again, they had penalty advantage there, so
team okay.
It was a free ball. If Wycherley had got held up, it wouldn't have been a goal line dropout. They would have had the penalty, so they're really just stamping their authority on the game now.
Craig Evans has got a better angle of that to give the try than we did on the evidence of that replay, but absolutely no doubt in his mind, nor indeed in the mind of Jake Flannery, who just dispatches the conversion. And Munster cruising towards half time now, a long, long way back already for this Zebre side, who at times have been bereft of how to deal with Munster on that set piece in particular when they get into the 22 and use that line out.
Yeah, it all stems from obviously Violi giving away the penalty in the halfway line. Zebre then get their own line out, they don't throw it straight. You know, it's just simple mistakes are really costing them dearly. And again, when you're in the back of losing streaks, confidence isn't there to deal with that at times.
Good carry from Jack O'Sullivan. So many in this Munster side, and indeed
those
who ticks on in the second half will be keen to impress. So you'd imagine Johan van Graan and others will be saying, look, no let up here.
On the line, okay, mate. On the line.
It's another good exit from Neil Cronin, and that's exactly what Zebre are struggling to do. They're struggling to exit well. Munster have dealt with kickoffs well and exited well, and they're keeping Zebre at bay.
He, another player who's he's had plenty of injuries, but he's had to wait for his opportunities as well. Oh, there's an intercept pass, and they will have a route back into the game at least, or onto the scoreboard. Pass inside, doesn't go to hand. Instead, it falls into the grateful arms of the 25-year-old South African, Eric Cronje, the outside centre, and he counters in under the bin for 5 points for Zebre. That's exactly what they needed. A little is something out of nothing, gift wrap for them, but a good read also.
Yeah, super from Eric Cronje, and we saw him with good line speed earlier on in the kick chase, and he's obviously come up hard there again, backed himself to Flannery, who's going to go for quick hands, and that's exactly what Zebre needed. They just needed something just to go their way, and that's going to be a 7-pointer, which will be great for them. And it actually came from Zebre losing their own line out, you know, and Munster then trying to move it. So Eric Cronje's made a read, and it's paid off dividends.
Right on half time, Tim O'Malley adds the extras, and they get their 7 points. And that will won't dramatically change the half time team talk, but it will get Zebre up and running for the second half when they win, staring down the barrel of another nil at half time. They have got themselves onto the scoreboard, but it's been a dominant Munster display. Half time in Parma, Zebre 7, Munster 22. Welcome back. All set to go then for the second half here in Parma. Munster first out of the dressing rooms after the halftime team talk, which will have been largely rather pleasing, I would imagine, with the exception of that concession of an intercept try to Eric Cronier right on 40 minutes, converted then by Tim O'Malley to leave the score at 22 points to 7. Zebra smartly out for the second half as well, and really the onus on them now to try and contain this Munster side and maybe just eat a little bit more into the deficit of 15 points at halftime and make this something of a contest. But the smart money would say that Munster will kick on from this position, having already scored three tries and certainly get the bonus point. As I mentioned, they have made a habit of scoring seven or eight tries against Zebra in recent history. Lots of players, of course, trying to make the most of this something of a rarity of game time and put their hands up for further selection at this disjointed time in the calendar. Of course, we didn't expect to see too many games rescheduled within that Six Nations window, but it's going to give the likes of Jack O'Sullivan and John Hodnett, maybe Jake Flannery and Jack Crowley, a little bit more game time over the next 4 or 5 weeks.
Absolutely, and the guys will be relishing it, you know, and it's the same across all the provinces. There's going to be young players getting opportunities and getting slightly more than what they maybe thought they would be getting. So it was frustrating at the time over the Christmas period, but there'll be players that now reap the benefit of that.
Stay in.
And you would imagine that the Munster dressing room was pretty happy with their efforts over the opening 40 minutes, and certainly in those one or two occasions where they did try and go wide and play an expansive game, they were reasonably clinical. Fabiani with a decent bust here. He's ever looking to make inroads and start the second half at a rate of knots. Into the arms of Mitchell on that blindside flank. Violi again, quicker ball now and recycled to the club captain, David Ceci, one of those players in that Italian squad. Here's Mitchell with his hands on it again, and he's sent back, repelled by Lockman and Klein. Two-man tackle. Jack O'Donoghue in there, can't quite get the rip. Violi again, Mitchell again, and Cronje.
Release!
Here they come again with Bejo, the tight head prop, making inroads just right up to that 22.
Timing is good.
Bianchi now, and he got his hands free. There was nobody really on his left shoulder as an obvious target for the offload, which would have been audacious. Maybe they'll do better just to set up a few phases here and try and suck in a little bit of that Munster cover, get themselves set.
Use.
O'Malley is there, all the big targets lined up. Lockman makes the tackle. Violi now, and it goes to Diamari Iroli, and on now to CC again. Decent start this for Zebra. Is there to be an end product? Big hit going in from Witcherly.
Not on the board.
Munster hands in on there. Gallagher's gone to ground. Ball is still available for the Zebra scrum half, and Bejo now carries on.
Away.
Tackled by Witcherly. O'Donoghue's got himself on the wrong side. He's been helped into that situation by a Zebra player, but he has been pinged. Penalty advantage. Cover back there by Shane Daly will go back for the indiscretion.
That's a bit of a needless penalty to give away there from Jack O'Donoghue. And, you know, Zebra obviously were playing with a bit of tempo. They were looking very bright and had started the second half well there, but they'd actually slowed up in their attack. They weren't really causing Munster a lot of problems, and I think Jack O'Donoghue could easily roll out the other way there. And but if you're in the Zebra dressing room, that's exactly what you're saying at half time. You're saying, right, we've got that 7-pointer just at the end of the half there. If we can get in and score next, it makes it a game again. And obviously, they can reduce it now to 12-point deficit if they get this kick, and it'll be game on.
I can assure the team we're checking everything in the background, and if something stands out in the replays or during the game, you bring it to my attention. Okay, trust me on the process, please.
Didn't quite get the start of that conversation between Jack O'Donoghue and Craig Evans, but the Munster captain unhappy with something. Just checking with that the officials are checking the TMO. Maybe something off the ball. But the opportunity, and a straightforward one at that, for the New Zealander Tim O'Malley to reduce the deficit still further. So Zebra look as though they'll be the side to score either side of half time.
A New Zealander who sounds like he must have some Irish heritage in there somewhere.
You would expect so. And Judy dispatches the 3 points, and that is exactly what the new head coach at Zebra would have called for at half time. 22 points to 10. Just puts a little bit more air in the tires of these Zebra players, because it's easy to become deflated when you're chasing a 22 point advantage as it was, but all of a sudden that reduced to 12. As Jake Flannery gets us going again. Really good high hanging restart. Up it goes from Violi, drifting into that 5 metre challenge over on the far side. Well watched by Matt Gallagher. Doesn't do a hand, and Munster again. Try and click in these wide areas. Here's Hodnett again. Never one to shy away from the physical contact. Just drives in off that left foot. And they've got men over the ball, and they've turned it over and got the penalty. Got a little bit about them in this second half now. Tiamo Rioli coming up with the goods.
Yeah, Zebra needed that. It was actually a bit of a poor read from Pierre Bruno. He bit in on Liam Coombs when he didn't need to. He had defenders inside him, and Josh Hodnett made great ground, but that's a great penalty turnover from Tiamo Rioli. And again, we talked about this in the first half, how Zebra were giving away a few needless penalties at times and then giving Munster field position. Well, it's kind of started the other way now for Zebra, and they're able to get down into Munster territory.
Very strong over the ball there from the Zebra number 8, despite the best intentions of Shane Daly, and then Jack O'Donoghue to uproot him. He was going absolutely nowhere. Fabiani has got to hit his targets, and they do, and it's quick ball into midfield. A little bit of pep in the step of these Zebra players now. Certainly if they can find another score. Start to ask the questions of Munster, who've gone into their shell perhaps just a little bit.
Tackle is completed.
That time the tackle was complete. And it looks like it's
tackle complete there.
Cronje over on that far side. So Munster back up into Zebra territory, and an opportunity from this lineout just to kickstart their second half. Really, 7.5 minutes in, they haven't really got motoring just yet. Jeremy Byrne from Cashel, Munster Schools Cup winner during his time at Brockwell College. There's that straight. Jack O'Donoghue got his hands on it. Hodnett. All endeavour, ever busy, open side flanker now. Lockman taken to ground early. Cronin. Ball loose off the carry from Dan Goggin that time. Here goes O'Sullivan. Can he spot a little bit of a gap? That's a really good carry. Now they get numbers with him. Quick ball required here. Good pickup. Looked like Keenan Knox. Good hands from the tight head now over the top from Flannery and over the top of Calvin Nash and into touch. Maybe just forcing it a little.
Yeah, it's a bit unfortunate. That's the exact word I was just thinking of. He's just tried to force that. He's seen the Zebra get up high in defence, and he thought the space is there, but he could have maybe just played Jack O'Sullivan, or Jack O'Donoghue, sorry, there, and just kept the ball for another phase. It's a great carry from Jack O'Sullivan to actually give Munster that go forward, and we've seen the likes of him and John Hodnett, sorry, just create that go forward ball from Munster, and the Zebra tackling at times has been a wee bit soft, I think, in around those close exchanges.
Some running repairs for Dan Goggin. Okay. Hodnett have been very good. He's in that rich vein of form, and Sullivan too tonight. A lot of Munster supporters keen to see Alex Kendallan off the bench again. Such a talented player in that back row. They've got such good players coming through.
Okay. Zebra five.
I was really, really impressed with Alex Kendallan and his under-20 Ireland setup, and he certainly looks like he's someone who's going to come through and compete at the top level.
Half a dozen tries in his five games. Captain the side too. Made his Heineken Cup debut against Cast. And Zebra the first to go to the bench in numbers. Zalocci and Krumov coming in. TOC is Zalocci, one of the players in that Italian squad, so looking forward to the Six Nations, which it's underway next week.
Thanks a lot. Yeah, he's coming towards you.
Zalocci probably can do with a little bit of game time. He's had a couple of injuries this season, which means that this is only his second appearance. And obviously, well, the attention to Dan Goggin is enough to force his withdrawal, so that's disappointing for him. Straight into the action is Leonard Krumov. Wins the line out and the ball there under the arm of Fabiani.
Keep it up! Not sleep, stay.
Chris Farrell in. It's the Munster switch for Goggin. Now, what can they manufacture here? Nash was just clipped as he almost managed to spot a gap over the top. It goes from Flannery. Good option from the Munster 10, and a pin Zebra back in where they don't want to be.
Yeah, that's what Munster were very effective in the first half. Once they got 10 metres away from that Zebra line, they just really got the stranglehold on them, and they're now back in the Zebra 22. And we've seen so many maul or line-out variations here so far from them today. They've attacked around the peel, around the front, so they'll go for the conventional maul.
Line initially and now Barron. And momentum building.
Through the middle.
Very elongated shape about that maul. The Zebra player in the middle of things is okay. Came through the middle and Cronin might just elect to try and get things moving. And Chris Farrell is a good target in this situation. Goes out the back. Flannery couldn't hold it. He knocked it on before it then went off a Zebra hand. Put into the home side.
That was well read from Pierre Bruno, I think it was, that came up there, and he read the play at the back, and that's one thing that Chris Farrell is really, really good at. He's a big ball carrier, but he's got a really good handling set as well. And I actually remember him when I was in the Ulster setup, and I remember him still being at school, and I saw this big kid lining out for Campbell College in Belfast, and most big kids tend not to have as good skill sets sometimes because they're just given the ball and told to run. And I was so impressed with Chris Farrell, his handling, his ability to offload, his wide passing game. And again, another player who's not in the Irish squad. He's obviously had a few injuries, but there's just so much competition for centre places, and it's a real bonus that Ireland have at the minute.
Absolutely. 15 caps to his credit in the Green of Ireland so far for Chris Farrell, but not, well, he's certainly in the conversation, but not quite in the forefront of the picture. Waiting in the wings with the likes of Stuart McCluskey and others, perhaps for recognition under Andy Farrell.
Time on.
So halfbacks changes for Zebra. 50 minutes into the game, 22 points to 10 in Parma. Munster was seen heading towards an 18th straight win over Zebra. And yet another win this season. They've been very, very good of late.
Crouch! Bind! Set!
Put in for the newly introduced Alessandro Fusco then. Ball one fine touch. Gallagher swings one in field to Galvin Nash and sends it forward. That's a little bit loose and unnecessary. He's tried to get himself involved as much as possible. Galvin Nash coming in off that right wing at every occasion to try and find gaps in the Zebra rear guard, but they're making too many rudimentary errors, really unforced, not under a great huge amount of pressure.
Yeah, and I think we saw that in the first half. You know, the first sort of 10, 15 minutes were quite scrappy in the first half. It sort of started the same way, and Munster just haven't really settled into this half yet. And Nash is working really, really hard, but he probably needed Gallagher just to carry there. It looked as if he was always going to be slightly in front. So certainly his endeavours there, it's just slight timing's just off, but you can expect that with so many changes that it won't always be there just in the correct timing.
Hold it. I've only called Crouch this week.
Matt Gallagher was beginning to get a little bit of game time when he injured his shoulder against Zebra in December of 2020, which forced him out for quite a while. Scored those couple of tries a little bit before that against the Newport Gwent Dragons at Rodney Parade. But he's been very, very limited in terms of the impact that he's been able to make since coming in.
Crouch!
Said, just his third start of this campaign. Tries in 47 games for Saracens before his arrival at Tolman Park. Zebra enjoying this scrum. Looking towards Craig Evans, holding on very much in the ascendancy, waiting for the whistle to blow and to confirm the penalty. Those little energizers that might just get this Zebra side moving again if they, well, shot is called, but they might go for the corner, but obviously Antonio Rizzi feels this is within his range.
Yeah, I would like them maybe to have seen them go down the line there, but obviously maybe they feel if they can just keep chipping away at this Munster lead, you know, two penalties brings it back to a one-score game, so certainly you talked about energizer, and it's a bit of a momentum swing, you know, when you get that forward pass, then it leads to a scrum, you then get a penalty from the scrum, and all of a sudden Munster could potentially go down by 3 points here, or sorry, concede 3 points purely on the basis of a mistake that they made, which is probably not really needed.
Preparing to make a couple of switches, and from the moment that left his boot, Antonio Rizzi, like everyone else inside the Lanfranchi, knew that he didn't have the legs to get there.
Downward pressure.
We're vindicated. He should have gone down the line.
All behind Salanoa will be introduced very shortly for Keenan Knox. Way downfield by Flannery to Laloifi.
Hold it front. Stay right, stay.
Antonio Rizzi straight down the middle this time.
Oh, sorry. Oh, offside.
Flannery. Okay. Has a little bit of a look.
Offside.
The assistant referee, I think, on this near side is the one communicating with
three
Craig
red.
Evans.
Three red. You?
An offside against
okay, three.
Keenan Knox,
three,
I believe.
Always offside, always advancing.
That was a soft penalty again to give away. Both teams were actually quite lazy in retreating there. You could see that neither team had an opportunity to counter-attack because no one was actually working to get back. And there's a bit of kick tennis. It's going to continue unless somebody actually works hard, and neither team really worked hard to get back and try and give an attacking option.
Offside.
Jeremy Lochman and Keenan Knox both withdrawn as Josh Witcherly and Roman Salanoa come into this Munster team. 56th minute of the game. Maintaining this 22-10 advantage with that missed penalty, but they're going to find themselves a little bit under the pump here. If Oliviero Fabiani can find his targets at line-out time. Try and get this Zebra side moving forward again.
Nine.
Good contest from O'Donoghue, but Zebra secure it. Rock solid maul defence. Zebra going nowhere there. Moving a little bit, a couple of Munster players go to ground. Sean Klein and Witcherly, I think, an advantage for that. Backward going for the penalty. Just a word of warning, surely, for O'Donoghue.
Offside, line out. Wasn't like
it's great covering from John Hodnett in behind there.
Have a quiet word, please. Penalty here, collapse.
It's feeling witcherly, isn't it, with the white scrum cap?
Okay, the penalty here, so that it was over.
Plenty of chat with what to do here. We're going to pop this into the corner. That is the decision. So a big call. Looking for five or seven here. Just enjoying a little bit of a purple patch. Munster a little bit off colour in the opening 15 minutes or so of this second half. Yet to find any real rhythm, and they're all hands to the pump defensively here. Fabiani has it. Zerno secured it. Now can they get forward momentum? Slowly building. Munster coming through. Jeremy Barron is in danger of being penalised there. Fusco can play it. Alessandro Fusco out into midfield. Really good tackle. Chris Farrell using his ballast and bolt there. Bianchi now. Trying to get beyond Josh Witcherly. Straighten the line that time through David Ceci. Good opportunity this for Zebra now to try and further erode that deficit on the scoreboard.
Let the ball go, go
not held, that was okay. Antonio Rizzi, now do they have numbers to the right hand side? They managed to get hands on with Jacobo Trulla, very dangerous player. Drifting out to this near touchline on the carry. Oh, it's loose. Fusco had to be quick to get in there and try and get his hands on it. Real scrap for it now on the floor. It's coming back on the Zebra side.
Lifted.
Strong tackle again.
Second man, leave it.
And there it is, and you can hear the Zebra replacements urging their side forward here, but Munster have pushed them back a good 10, 15 metres here. Fusco once more.
Back foot, stay.
Antonio Rizzi managed to evade the first tackle, ran into two Munster players. They're finding precious little change out of this Munster rear guard so far. They need some kind of impetus going forward, change things up a little bit. And they look to Lucin, the inside centre. Ball there for Fusco again. Munster off the line pretty quickly. The scrum half taking the circuitous route around that far side.
Stay.
Replacement fly half. Rizzi gets them moving again, this time to Jacopo Bianchi. Fusco again. Diamariroli just on that 22. Gradually and slowly being forced back though by this Munster defensive set, which will end in a turnover. Really just takes all the air and the life out of Zebra, being pummeled backwards, and then the shrill blast, all that hard work comes to nothing. Good defence from Munster.
Yeah, and I think Munster look very comfortable in defence there. I don't think Zebra have got an awful lot really that they're able to trouble Munster with. It's just Munster being patient, not giving away any silly penalties, and their time will come. Two absolutely massive tackles from Chris Farrell in there. That really helped stem things, and a huge hit on Pierre Bruno. And again, Munster just look like they are comfortable, and I don't think Zebra just have enough of a game plan that they're going to be able to break through that Munster team.
Do you want the flag?
It's got to be a little bit disheartening, but they've got to keep going, keep believing, Zebra, that they can puncture that Munster rear guard. As you did say, it was a little bit of shadow boxing almost. Munster looked pretty comfortable, holding them at arm's length. Barron finding Witcherly. And he's had a big impact off the bench. Chris Farrell, both sides of the ball, as you expect he would, a player of his calibre. O'Donoghue, really good wrestling match.
You pulled off feet. You pulled him off feet. Play on.
Cronin, Salanoa.
Tucker,
that's a good
release.
Two-man hit. Salanoa forced backwards, takes some doing. Flat to the line, and Coombs in there. Munster looking for quick ball off Cronin. That's better. And the pass from Flannery doesn't go to hand. Salanoa. He's got a bit of a kick there. Awkward fall.
You okay? He didn't look that good on the floor. That's a bit of a whistle.
I think it was his, it's his left wrist, I think, okay, but referee well within his rights to stop that, given the nature of the challenge. He maybe thought it was a kick to the head. Turns out Salanoa looks to be pretty much okay, thankfully.
Yeah, I initially thought it was maybe a kick in the hand or in around the wrist area, so hopefully he's not hurt, but hopefully it's definitely nothing more sure he did get us. Was the wee flailing arm maybe did just catch him, yeah.
Okay, I just stopped to see if he didn't look that good, so we're going to restart with the red scrub. Yeah. Zebra, one and two, sub.
A couple of changes in the pack now for the Italian side. Siciliani and Lavotti coming in. Important from a Munster point of view in games like this that they can get game time into the likes of Keenan Knox and Roman Salanoa. I mean, it's been much talk about that Munster tight five when it comes to the big European games and invariably these semi-final matches against the top tier Pro 14 and URC sides, namely Leinster, as it has been perennially over the last 3 years, that maybe that's where they're just at that disadvantage. And it's the injuries to Keenan Knox and Salanoa and others that have held them back more than anything, that we haven't seen as much of them, I'm sure, as Johan van Graan would like.
Absolutely, and it's just having that quality. You know, you can't just rely on 15 or 23 players nowadays, just with the game so physical. Players end up on rest periods with internationals and pick up knocks and bumps, and you really need to be able to call on at least 30, 35 players that you know you can depend on in any big game. And certainly Keenan Knox has looked good. We know Jeremy Loughton's continued to develop really, really well, which is a positive. Dave Kilcoyne over the last couple of years has really found another gear again in his game, so it's been a big positive for them.
And talking about the 100th cap for John Klein, Dave Kilcoyne itching to get his 200th cap, and he's been due to play a couple of times, but he's going to have to wait a little bit longer now as well.
Yeah, you always feel nervous for people when they're on that. It's like a cricketer when they're sitting in 99 not out. They just want to poke a single and get to that 100. And certainly it'd be a huge achievement for Dave Kilcoyne, especially for a front rower. I think in general, any front rower that's able to amass 200 plus games or 100 games, you know, for their internationally or anything like that, it's phenomenal with the attrition those guys take.
Salanoa certainly is okay to continue, and Zilocki as well. He's been patched up and ready to continue, take his place in that front row for this Munster put-in from Neil Cronin.
Crouch! Bind! Set! Ball in, let's go. Stay close. Use it!
Two front rows down, and there is the cry of use it from Craig Evanson. Fished out of the second row by Neil Cronin. Now walking Munster manufacturing the wide expanses on this near side. Big tackle goes in. Foot in touch on this near side. A couple of really physical hits there, just bringing the energy levels back up again. Shane Daly, no room to work in, and well met.
Yeah, again, I think Munster will be a wee bit disappointed. I think Liam Coombs does really well to try and get to the edge and try and get Shane Daly away, but you don't really just want to go laterally in the touch. I think certainly he looked a bit close. He might not have even been quite fully in touch, but obviously if you touch the line at all with any part of your foot, it's deemed as being out of play, so... Just coming in towards the final 15 minutes here, you know, Munster will be a wee bit nervy now, I think.
Okay, 14's up.
They'll wanted to get that bonus point early on and just kill the game off, but Zebre now have still got an opportunity to come back into this.
Massimo Siciliani all the way over the back. Giammaruoli.
12 brought to the ground.
Stop! Hold!
Knocked downfield by Antonio Rizzi. Into the arms of Shane Daly, who immediately makes up his mind. He's going to send that ball way up into the sky. Really good take.
14, always in front.
It's an offside, though, is there, against Pierre Bruno, I think.
14 is always ahead of the kick. 14 always ahead of the kicker.
One of those relatively needless entry points into the game. Munster, well, after the really good take, particularly under the high ball, called back and pinged for the penalty for Bruno being offside.
Yeah, it's going to give Munster a good opportunity here to get deep into the Zebre 22. And again, it looks marginal, but again, there's nothing to stop you staying half a metre onside instead of being half a metre offside. You know, it's a very careless penalty to give away, and it's not really acceptable at this level, especially if you're out in the wing. You can see everything inside you. You've got the full vision of the pitch.
Yeah. Just look where it puts the Zebre team, Pierre Bruno. As I mentioned, is in that Italy squad and has played pretty well this season. Made his debut for the Azzurri against Uruguay in November. Scored a try. But his team on the back foot here.
Good stick.
Munster haven't registered since that Finnan Wycherley converted try.
Four's always bumped. That's one snipe.
Plenty of Zebre players around this side. Cronin just trying to ascertain exactly where it is. They've gone to ground and he's trying to excavate it from that body of players, and eventually it is there for the Munster number 9. Farrell again is the go-to player. Quicker this time for Cronin. Now Salanoa, a decent option also. Here they come again. Farrell again gets himself out a little bit wider, looking to cause some damage. Cronin will come back inside now to O'Sullivan. Sustained pressure and sustained power from Chris Farrell. He's determined to have a real impact and get his name on the score sheet. Here they go with Klein. Would be fitting were he to manage to get across the whitewash on his 100th appearance.
Back foot, block, back foot.
His one-out carries Munster normally so good from this kind of position, just relentless, wearing the opposition down. Will they try something a little bit different? Cronin almost on the stretch, thought he might get there on his own. On the follow-up, that looks pretty good. There's an outstretched arm, which is dotting it down. Craig Evans goes in there.
Time off.
And this is the first time this evening in the 67th minute that we're going to go upstairs for verification from the TMO, who is Alan Falzone.
The decision is no try because I haven't got a clear ground in. Can you just check for that, please?
Well, let's see. I'm not sure initially who exactly felt that they had the levers to try and reach out with the ball in hand. It can't have been a million miles away. It's Cronin initially. And then Hodnett goes in. I think it might be it's the arm of Hodnett, isn't it? Now that looks pretty good on the evidence of that. Yeah, it is going to be a try. So it is the bonus point try that they've had to work long and hard to get, Munster. But they do get their fourth try of the evening and their first score in this half. And it's duly converted by Jake Flannery. So all that effort tumbling towards the line pays off.
Okay.
Yeah, it all stems back to a needless penalty. You know, Pierre Bruno gives away a really poor penalty. He's in the Six Nations squad. He's an international quality player. It's a poor mistake. And we've seen Munster be so clinical when they've got into the 22 and they've just ground out yard after yard. And it's a good finish. And that really should put the game beyond Zebre now.
Yeah, it just knocks the stuffing out of them, really, doesn't it? All of a sudden, you're staring down the barrel of a 19-point deficit again with time very much against you. But how good has Farrell been since his introduction? Thumps one down the channel of Laloifi. Antonio Rizzi just knocked that on. Flannery now, opportunity here for Munster if they can spread it. Carl will do that.
Release tackler! Okay, advantage over.
That's Candelon's first real involvement since he's been sprung from that Munster bench. Shane Daly, who's seen quite a decent amount of ball on this side. Zebra have it back now with Fusco running into Jeremy Barron.
Use! Ball is out.
Further changes on the Zebra side as well.
Nine, let's go, please.
Both coaches emptying the benches. 12 minutes and thereabouts to go. Up in the air it goes again. So I didn't quite judge that one. Got his timing a little bit wrong. Was on the way down as the ball came to him and made it more tricky than it might have been. Posted high and long by Cronin. Kick chase this time is good. Daly into Antonio Rizzi.
Use it!
Daly hasn't got the ball in his hands a lot in attack, but he has kick chased well, and those little things make a big difference.
Yes.
And you can see both he and Calvin Nash absolutely itching to get any kind of opportunity. As you say, he hasn't really had a clear cut one, and when he has, he's been either well marshalled or is just run out of pitch at times.
Yeah, the game has lacked a little bit of quality in terms of both teams attack wise, but again, sometimes you have to grind out victories, and certainly it looks like Munster have done that now. They've got their bonus point, and we would expect them to go on and win this with 10 minutes to go. But as a winger on a nice dry night on a hard pitch, you're hoping to kind of get the ball in a bit of space, and it just hasn't really happened.
As I said, Thomas O'Hearn, some treatment for him. And he scored 16 tries in the last two games, but it's not been that type of game or anything like it. It's not been a fluid performance from Munster. I think that's your diplomatic saying that it's lacked quality at times. That could be deemed generous. It's been pretty poor at times, hasn't it? But then again, you make 11 changes, you come away from home and you put yourself in a position 22 points to nil up. Sometimes it's hard to maintain that level and that discipline to play at full throttle all of the time when arguably the result is a foregone conclusion.
You're absolutely right, and there's so much expected now in the back of the last 2 weeks, and it's easy to forget how many changes there are, and it does take a wee bit of time to adjust again. And the Italian teams aren't always the cleanest to play against. They want to make it scrappy and slow it down.
16, keep your bind, stay where you are. That's red to ground.
Just confirmation of that latest touchdown, the bonus point try. Actually, it was the outstretched arm of Josh Witcherly. We're being confirmed. So, full house for the Witcherly household tonight. Two tries of the Munster four going to the Witcherly brothers. Back inside from Flannery towards Cronin. That went backwards. Chris Farrell looks absolutely nailed on to get a try at some point. He's still got 10 minutes to do so. Munster might yet get a fifth off this attack as they go with Farrell again. Seen a huge amount of ball on this, a little bit of space there, and then Zebra just in time shut the door.
Advantage.
But you would not back against Munster from this kind of range to score yet another pushover try with the advantage all the while.
Offside.
It's nice play again from Jake Flannery. He's taken it to the line a couple of times. He's managed to get through, get his hands free, and he's tried to offload to Neil Cronin, who's been there running that good support line as scrum halves do. And it's been a nice variation from Flannery tonight.
Your players, that was the time
as we've been saying, just his second start for the Tipperary 22-year-old and his first at fly half. And a lot of his club rugby recently for Shannon has been played from that full back berth.
You're all up, you're good. Time on. Offside. Munster.
Going to see Scott Buckley for the final 10 minutes. They might just tap this Munster. Or is Jack Crowley going to stick it into the corner? Yes, he is.
Time in, down.
29-10, so plenty of time just to put a little bit of gloss on what's been a patchy performance with the possibility of a fifth, maybe a sixth try.
Inside the
Captain
five,
Jack O'Donoghue takes it. Wheeling around to that side where there's not a lot of room, but is there enough room just to drive over? They're very close and they do get a fifth try. That's really good work. And it's Jermot Barron who comes up with Munster's fifth try.
I think that's really been the difference in the two sides. It's when Munster have got into that 22, been 10 metres out, they've just really put the foot on the throttle and they've been able to come away with points each time. We've seen Zebre down there a couple of times and they've got knocked back 10 metres, whereas Munster are advancing 10 metres towards the try line and the wind will be truly out of the sails. Now, I think that could have even been a penalty try if it hadn't been a try. It looked like one of the Zebre front rowers came in from the side and tried to collapse it, so I think it's nice the referee let it play out. I think it's nicer someone gets a try instead of a penalty try in the score sheet.
Finished off nicely. Four of the five Munster tries then to the forwards. Time too to see Paddy Patterson getting some game time. Decent shift for Neil Cronin. Didn't leave too much out there. Much more difficult than this for Jack Crowley.
Zebra,
he can't add the extras.
Eight. Okay.
34 points to 10. Very much job done. And Munster in cruise control. Heading towards an 18th successive win over their Italian opponents. It's actually Ethan Coughlin, because that was a late change to the Munster bench for Paddy Patterson. Ethan Coughlin wearing 21 tonight, so he's come in for Neil Cronin.
It's lifted.
And here he is, as Munster look to come and search something in the dying embers here. 6 or 7 minutes to go.
Clear release.
And credit to Bianchi, the open side there, got himself in a good position and gives his side the penalty.
Yeah, Farrell just lost his momentum. He juggled the ball a bit there and it meant he ended up in contact without any real momentum, any go forward. And it's good from Zebre. It'd be nice for them to finish on a bit of a high. They have had periods of possession and territory. They just haven't, as we said earlier, and they probably haven't had the quality to go and follow through on it. But
Krumhoff wins that cleanly. Back under the arm of Siciliani.
Stay where you are, where you are.
Not going anywhere in a hurry.
Block us once. Okay, ball caught in the five. Nine.
Forced to use it by some resilient Munster Maul defence. Alessandro Fusco, Antonio Ruzzi. Good tenacity about the Munster challenges. With a fresh impetus of a raft of players off the bench. Fusco again, good delivery out to Ruzzi, and then they get it all a little bit wrong, but a big gap appears and Ruzzi will make good yardage here. Thought he had numbers to the left-hand side. He might have delivered that, and that's a poor pass, but it might yet profit something on this near side.
Back, hold it red, hold.
All of a sudden, it's all very fast and loose in the last 5 minutes of the game as Zebre come in search of a try. Ruzzi not. And they're testing that Munster rear guard.
No.
Important tackle from Coombs, just managed to hold on. Munster player in there off his feet, playing it on the ground. Very, very obvious penalty. Jack Crowley gives away.
You got the penalty, what more can you have? That's the penalty's for, okay? Calm it down.
Well, I'll take a yellow card ref if you're offering one, but he's not going to get one.
Yeah, time is still off.
Yeah, shout out there to Roman Salamona. Get back there and made a great tackle on Ritzy. So, you know, at this stage of the game, it's easy to switch off. It's easy to think, oh, the game's gone. Salamona chases back there as a tight head drop, and I know he hasn't started the game, but it's the last 5 minutes, and he's made a great cover tackle there in Ritzy to help prevent the try.
One or two on both sides, blowing pretty hard. It's been an attritional sort of contest. As we said, quite a few of these Munster players have been plying their trade in the AIL in recent weeks, and a little bit of a step up to this kind of endeavour and intensity. It's been a workmanlike performance, shall we say, from this much-changed Munster side. And invaluable in terms of the likes of Jake Flannery there, who's just learned out via the PA system that I think he is tonight's man on the match. And he looked pretty surprised and then suddenly very delighted. And why would he not?
Yeah, I like this humility. I think he said, really? You know, so I think he's had a good game. It's his first start of 10 at this level. And I think he's varied his game really well. I think he's looked very assured.
3 minutes left in the game. The scrums have been fine, okay? I don't want you going soft now towards the end.
And all of that after getting an almighty bang in the head, which we thought we weren't going to see him after the opening 5 or 10 minutes or so. He spent an awful lot of time getting patched up inside, and
we rest on a bang, we don't push forward.
Came back on and did his business extremely well. Very encouraging.
These are hard scrums to defend as a Munster team. You're looking, there's space on both sides. 5 metres out, you can't afford to give away the gain line. And
set! Steady!
Hopefully Zebra have something to up their sleeve.
Steady!
Munster front row down, there is the advantage. So all bets are on the table here.
The penalty advantage to black.
It's a good tackle, it's an important tackle from Coombs. Not his first of the evening, might I say, in that outside centre position. Still with the advantage there for Fusco, comes back against the grain. Rootsy puts it towards Lucene, who can't hold it. It's a little bit of afters right at the end. No need for that, really. Zebra in a hurry to try and get on with it.
Collapse.
Get themselves the consolation try that
Number
this
three,
last little passage of
collapse.
Clay has deserved.
You're going to go scrum again?
Well, the graphic there showing the scrum. URC player of the match to be Neil Cronin, and he did have a good game, in fairness.
Maybe that's why Jake Flannery was saying, really?
Yeah.
Maybe he thought, should it not be Neil?
Unless his teammates were on a little bit of a wind-up.
Yeah. No, Neil Cronin's had a good solo game as well. He's box-kicked very well. We talked about the likes of Shane Daly chasing those kicks well. Calvin Nash chasing hard.
Chase his feet, and you keep the elbow up.
Second start of the season for Cronin. He did come off the bench in those two games earlier this month against Connacht and Ulster, though. And so where are we? 79th minute of the game, 34-10.
Bind! Set!
Zebra keep it up. Endeavouring to finish with a flourish and add a try to their second half efforts. Just that one penalty from Tim O'Malley. And it looked as though he might get a try. Whistle's gone, though.
Boys, look, 12.
I think, was it Alex Kandel in there, maybe? 12. Saying he might have been getting held in.
Look, I can only apologise. I've gone tight to the scrum, but I've got in the way. It's going to be a zebra scrum.
Yeah, I did hear the protestations of one or two Munster players, so Craig Evans calling that one on himself.
Ball came away.
Yeah, that pretty much sums it up.
Same scrum.
Not impressed, Enrico Lucine. Let's see. Yeah, Kandela would have got there. Not a huge amount Craig Evans can do about that, is it?
No. The referees have to be somewhere. I used to remember, like, years ago, we used to always be trying to run at the ref and use him almost as a decoy. And the odd time you see the referees getting caught up in it and they don't enjoy it.
Set!
Zebra don't get the benefit of the doubt there. Again, they've got that penalty advantage. They've scrummaged well at times tonight. And Munster are going to finish with a man down, maybe, here, are they? Had a couple of warnings, not necessarily.
Okay, that's two penalties now. Okay. Twice the captain on this scrum. Okay, need a better height from you. I know it's 18 minutes, not great to get a yellow card. But
yeah, there's no point really, is there? 34-10, we're in the 81st minute, but what do they do here? Take a tap, scrum again. They do have to seem to be in the ascendancy there. Sucks in plenty of numbers and gives them, as you say, options left and right.
I know it's the 80th minute, but he's already given them a warning. And if it's a yellow card offence for a penalty, it still probably should really be a yellow card. And I know it's immaterial in terms of the end of the game, but even still, as everyone will finish on a high, one player will go off. There might be just that one little bit of space that they can use.
Binds! Score! Set! Stay behind the ball.
Again, that front row of Munster crumbles. Oh, there was space there. That's good defence initially. Munster scrambling around to get numbers out to that far side to try and repel this one last threat. Well over the 80 minutes. Clock long since in the red. Five tries to one. Can they manufacture something here? That's good hands. The offload towards Laloifi. Now, did it go forward?
Off the knee, try.
Referee's
good.
Happy, it's come off the knee and they do get their try. The fullback who dots it down, Junior Laloifi, right at the very last play. Again, they had the advantage, but they do get their try.
Yeah, we heard Craig Evans saying there it would have been a yellow card there as well for that one, so that's good. Good to see Zebre getting to use the advantage, and that's nice to the line. We saw Nathan Doak last night for Ulster getting a nice wee kick through.
Yeah, so lovely little bit of...
Yeah, so Laloifi doing the same thing, this time for himself. And
two off the kicking seat, conversion dispatched. And they'll finish with, double scores, 34 points to 17 with the conversion. Goes over, they got four tries last week against Worcester in the Challenge Cup. They've got a couple here against Munster, but really... The argument was settled a long, long time ago. Munster huffed and puffed, and they got some game time into some of the younger players, and they win here by 34 points to 17 in Parma.